At the very heart and core of all these secret societies lurks the Kabbalah. It is a method of encoding information through a system of mathematics and numbers. These people that belong to the secret societies never dared to write down in any language what they knew, what it was that they were guarding, because then someone could steal it and then the secret would be out. So they took this knowledge and they made it occult through a system of encoding encryption, one of which is mathematics, numbers. Another is architecture. Anybody wonder why do they have a fraternal organization called the Freemasons? Aren't those the guys that build walls? You bet they do. But every wall they build contains the secrets that have been kept and maintained throughout the ages, and it's encoded in the architecture and in the measurements of the buildings and in the mathematical formulas used to derive the geometry, the shape, the length and breadth and height of rooms. It's all encoded.
Also in the street plan of Washington, you find pentagrams. So here we have two pentagrams in the street plan of Washington. The top one points into the Capitol building, and the one at the bottom points into the White House. This is a political building, so we're told. In fact, it's a temple to a secret society, built by the Freemasons to a specific design, Congress. The Congress building. Where did it get its name from? Capitol Hill. From a sacred place of the Roman Brotherhood going way back called Capitoline Hill. And when Madeleine Albright, high priestess of this Brotherhood, became Secretary of State, and she went across on her first overseas visit to Europe, she actually went to Rome and made an official visit at what for her would have been a pilgrimage to Capitoline Hill in Rome. And that's where we get Capitol Hill from. This is George Washington. In the last century, they decided they didn't have a decent statue of George, so instead of getting an American to produce one, they ordered it from Italy, from Florence. And when it arrived on the dockside, people were staggered, because here was George, the first president of the United States, depicted naked from the waist up with this cloth over his Bill Clinton's, and then pointing up one arm, pointing down the other. What's going on? Unless you realize where these people are coming from, it's inexplicable. Well, if you just hold that in your mind, arm up, arm down, naked from the waist up, and then Bill Clinton's covered in a piece of cloth, well, this is where it's coming from. This is the ancient depiction of the compilation of the negative force symbol that the Templars worshipped, or the high-level Templars worshipped anyway, called Baphomet. And this is why that they depicted George Washington.
Well, it's come to light, is that it's now been, it is not so surprising for a lot of people that there are covens amongst the very educated class. Architects, doctors, lawyers, priests, brokers, and the leisure class.
These are people who have made pacts with the devil.
That's right. It's really the best, the more accurate way of describing it would be that they have indulged themselves in the worship of the goat, of the prince, of the serpent, of Satan, of Lucifer. And they lead perfectly normal lives. They're jewel merchants. They travel. They're prominent in their own way. But they do have this indulgence.
Father, here's a part of that I can never understand. That has never made sense to me. And that is, if somebody were to make a pact with the devil, then obviously the implication is if the devil is there to make a pact with them, to make a deal, to make their life, their short mortal life on Earth, pleasurable, with money or women or travel.
More interesting.
Whatever it is they want.
Yes.
Then they are aware of the presence of the devil, and they are obviously aware then of the presence of God as well, and they nevertheless make a conscious, stupid, short-term, blind choice to take what they can get in this lifetime. And to embrace one, you must embrace the other. It's not like it's some wishy-washy prison.
I know you do. It is a very not easy to understand, except when you talk with them, when they let their hair down and peel grapes, as we say, and when they're on their way to being cured of what they're, or healed is the proper word, you find that there's an exhilaration and a satisfaction which is both sensual and sexual and mental when they really indulge in Luciferian worship. There is a peculiar exhilaration.
Like a drug, then?
Yes. Yes, it's a peculiar exhilaration. And, of course, the godly instincts in us all, the angelic in us all, because we all have something angelic and something godly, besides everything else, a lot of other negative things, that is quenched. And you find in them a horror of anything, what we call sacred and holy or sacrosanct. Or the idea of the sacred, of the awesome.
How in the world did you ever get involved in praying to demon spirits?
A fellow that had been on a particular ship with me, he told me, "Hey, I got something fantastic to tell you." He said, "I am affiliated with people that speak with the spirits of the dead. How would you like to talk to the spirit of your dead mother?" And I was shocked. I was shocked. He said, "You wouldn't be afraid of talking to the spirit of your dead mother, would you?" Well, I said, "I'll tell you what, I would have to give that some thought, because it's something I never thought about before in my life."
Most of us probably haven't, a little afraid of something like that.
Well, he says, you know, it's written all over your face. You're afraid of going to a seance. But he says, "I know you." He says, "You're going to come. You're afraid of going to a seance. But he says, "I know you." He says, "You're going to come." And then he started telling me how brave I was when I was aboard ship, you know. Different things. He says, "You're not the same man. You've changed. You're chicken." That's all I needed to hear. I said, "When do we go to a seance?" So one Saturday evening, we were in the place. It was her first time. Very beautiful place. A medium. It was a lady. She had a gorgeous new home in Montreal. And there were about 20 invited guests there. I was one of them. And she communicated with the spirits for different people there. And they were telling them what the spirit said. One man said, "I would like to talk to my friend that died 6 months ago. But I don't want him to appear. Just want to talk to him. Because," he says, "I don't trust you talking to my friend for me." Medium says, "Let me inquire of the spirit." "Yeah, the spirit will talk with you." And that big masculine voice was heard in the place. It says, "Hi, Frank. It's nice of you to ask for me to talk with you." And they had a little chat. And after it was over, Frank says, "This is the greatest thing honored, to be able to talk with the spirits of the dead." Then the medium said, "We have a very special surprise tonight for you people. A spirit will manifest itself openly here in a few minutes, And it's like a big gust of wind hit the building. And right through the wall. And the lights weren't terribly bright, but they were like living room lights. A couple of floor lamps and maybe some of these. And that translucent being seemed to come right out of the wall.
How did you feel right at that moment?
It's almost like my heart stopped a little bit. You know, very weird feeling. So it was a lady in a beautiful evening gown, floor length. And she said to Mary, "My dear sister, you are so wonderful to have asked for me." And Mary fainted and fell right off her chair on the floor. And a couple guys jumped up and picked her up, and it's very gone. That was the beginning of it.
That's how you got into it.
Yeah, that's the way I got into it. After a while, you see, there's something interesting about the human mind. You can adjust an awful lot of stuff. You can adjust to a lot of things that would terrify you to begin with. After a while, they become common and ordinary.
So you mean contact with the supernatural can become commonplace and ordinary and doesn't bother anybody?
Yeah. In other words, the more that you do it, you're not uncomfortable.
That's right.
It's just not an uneasy feeling.
Yeah. So how did you feel about it?
Then I got into a secret society that worshiped the spirits, you see.
How is that different from the seance, Roger?
It happens that the seance are not involving in many ways. But when you get into a secret society of spirit worshippers, then, and especially when you're invited there by the direction of the higher-ups in the spirit world, you never get out of there alive. And this is exactly what my friend and I were up against. We didn't know anything about it. And there was a very, very popular big band leader.
Jazz musician.
Band, yeah, very famous. And one night we went to one of these seances, and he was with his wife.
So, Roger, you're at this restaurant. What happened?
We sat there, and we had our favorite alcoholic beverages, you know. And as we talked, the band leader says, he says, "I want power. I go right to the source of power." And he says, "How do you think that I became famous the way that I am?" Well, I said, "You must have had some good luck." Well, he says, "There's no such thing as good luck." He says, "There's either some power working for you somewhere, or you don't get ahead in this world. Not in my type of occupation." So, it went from there. We got talking about spirit worship.
Did it intrigue you? Did it make you want to find out more about what exactly he was talking about?
Yeah. So, he said the supposed spirits of the dead that you're talking with are demon spirits. They're fallen angels. They're beautiful beings.
Just set it out, just like
oh,
that.
Yeah.
It didn't make you uneasy when he said they were...
Well, you know, it shocked you a little bit, you know. Something that you first hear mentioned to you. He said, "You guys have got a great future ahead of you. Because we've been told, the high priest of our society, secret society, has been told that the master has very special plans for you two."
Now, what did he mean by the master?
Satan. And we were interested to hear more about it. And he told us, he says, "Look, we worship spirits. We worship Lucifer and all his angels. They're just as beautiful as they did before they were cast out of heaven." He says, "There was a misunderstanding in the whole thing," he says, "among the inhabitants of the galaxies." And he says, "Our master was misunderstood, and God did not bear with him like he does with people that make mistakes today. So we're in a warfare, good against evil. And we happen to be the evil ones, but we're not that bad." He says, "I look at this business between the force of good and evil." He says, "You believe in one person believes in God, and everyone believes in Lucifer. It's like politics."
So the great controversy mm-hmm. is real. And you've heard someone talk about it that's on the other side.
Mm-hmm. The master of my life has revealed to me that it is time for you people to become acquainted with the worship room of the gods. Where they had the spirits that had materialized, they photographed them, and then they had paintings made of them. And there was probably about maybe 100 of those around the place.
So how did you feel when you walked into that room?
I felt that these people had power, and they had a lot of it.
Did that attract you?
Yes and no.
You had mixed feelings about it?
I had mixed feelings about it. Yeah. Because to a certain extent, things looked so good and sounded so good to us. But you see, I'd been brought up in a Christian home. My dad says, well, you know, if you get involved in wrongdoing, you're going to have to pay the price. There's always a cost for everything in this world. So this thought kept creeping to my mind. Just how far you go with these spirits before we start paying the price.
So it made you just a little bit nervous.
Oh, yes.
But yet you kept going back.
Oh, there was no way out. Because that's what we're told.
You knew at that time.
Yeah.
So you were moving forward more on fear.
More on fear, yes. Because the high priest said that the master had special plans for us in our lives. And that no one ever went into the society unless they were invited by the spirits. So that was made very clear.
In reality, Roger, you were chosen mm-hmm. by high-powered demon spirits yeah. to be a part of their human, special, privileged mm-hmm. group.
You see, these people in Montreal, the society, like the priest mentioned, there's thousands of spirit worshippers, you know, in different societies of spirit worshippers in this world. But he says, we are the elite. We know the real truth about the master and his angels. And they are not hideous looking beings. They are gorgeous creatures. And from the paintings that they had on the walls of that worship room.
Now, when you would go to these praise sessions, mm-hmm. what kinds of things happened at those sessions?
Well, there's a lot of success stories. The masters has done this for me and that for me. I remember one. Yeah.
At what point did this demon worship start to affect you personally, Roger?
Well, it wasn't too long that the priest mentioned to us that the time had arrived for us to start trusting the spirits and give the spirits a chance to work for us. And there was a number of gifts that you could choose from.
I think you might realize what you've got here. So why don't you just ruminate whilst I illuminate the possibility. Whilst I illuminate the possibility. Illuminate the possibility.
The priest mentioned to us that the time had arrived for us to start trusting the spirits and give the spirits a chance to work for us. And there was a number of gifts that you could choose from.
Well, Alibaba, Jabba had them 40 thieves. Sherazade had 1,000 tails. But master, you in luck, cause up your sleeves, you got a brand of magic never fails. You got some power in your corner now. It's heavy ammunition in your camp. You got some punch to dance. Jabba and Halsey, all you gotta do is rub that lamp. And I'll say,
Mr. Lancer, what will your pleasure be?
Let me take your order, jot it down.
You ain't never had a friend like me.
Here's your restaurant, and
I'm your maitre d'.
Come on, whisper what it is you want. You ain't never had a friend like me.
Yes, sir. We pride ourselves on service.
You're the boss, the king, the Shah. Say what you wish, it's yours, true dish. About a little more baklava. Pass on my column A, try all of column B. I'm in the mood to help you, dude. You ain't never had a friend like me.